Hello, and thank you for tuning in, all New England StarCraft players and anyone who else who may be listening. I'm your host, Brady Tatro, also known as Schreeder. I am here with the man, the myth, the legend, the man who is currently running the New England StarCraft League. I'm, of course, referring to Droggeth. Now, Droggeth, let's get to learn a little bit more about the man behind StarCraft. Give us a little bit about your family and life.
My real name's Patrick Buckley. I've been married for about 5 years this year, and I have a Amazonian daughter who's freaking tall for her age. She's 3. I actually work in research and development, and it's somewhat of a new field for me. I've been doing it for the past 2 years, and it's really great. I get paid to tinker. I don't really know. Not really much else that I can think of.
So, Droggeth, do you have any history with StarCraft or StarCraft Brood War? Or maybe do you have any kind of experience in casting or tournament organization which would have brought you into this whole field? Or did you just kind of decide when StarCraft 2 came out, you just kind of wanted to go with it, be a complete greenhorn about it?
That's a lot to answer. Let's see, as far as StarCraft goes, I do have some history with StarCraft and StarCraft Brood Wars. It's not a pretty history because I was really, really bad at both of those games. I could do campaign mode, build up a giant army and then attack out, like an hour, 2 hours later, something like that. As far as going on Battle.net goes, the only things that I did were like the big game hunter, money, money, no rush, 25-minute maps, and even then I would get raffle stomped because I'd make maybe one drone or one SCV. I don't really know which race I used at the time. It was either that or UMS maps. So I wasn't really big into the competitive scene. I really enjoyed the way that the game played, the strategy behind it. Albeit, most of my strategy was build up a giant force and then move out. There was still, that aspect, the strategy was still there. Let's see, as far as casting goes, my buddy Bliss, he goes by Adrenaline on the Team Liquid forums. I met him in beta. And he actually set up the first LAN that was in New England for StarCraft II. It was a beta LAN, and a whole bunch of people showed up, and I got to flex my StarCraft II muscles because I was extremely excited when it came out. And that was my first tournament, and I got to chat with everybody. And as I was playing that tournament and the next one that came up, I realized that there's a lot of people out there that are better than me. And I'm not gonna make any money or not really gonna get anywhere doing or joining the tournaments. So what I did find out doing is when I was trying to get better, I would watch my old replays and I noticed myself talking to myself, like exactly what's going on. This is what I'm doing. This is what's going on the field, almost like I was commentating my own fight to myself. So like, you know what? Wait a minute. I hear, HD. I hear Husky. The occasional Day9. You hear the recordings of people doing commentaries. Like, wait a minute. Maybe I can do something like this. So I think it was like the third LAN that I went to after I got knocked out. I was like, you know what? I'm gonna offer to do commentary for the tournament. Just kind of do it. I'm amateur. Whatever. Just jump right into the water. So that's where I started doing commentary. And from there, it took off a little bit. I got the YouTube page up. I started getting higher, like I got a new graphics card so I could do better graphics. Started learning the video editing a little bit better so I could increase the quality of everything. And there was a something happened. I think my wife got sick or something like that, so I couldn't commentate for a while, and I don't want to say I lost interest in it because I definitely didn't lose interest in it. It kind of staggered for a little while, And about that time, it was like really amazing timing wise. There was a tournament in, where was it, Kittery, Maine. It was thrown by a guy named Muzzy, and while we were at the tournament, it was like a 13-hour casting day for me. But a guy that was there was saying, you know, hey, I'm trying to get together this StarCraft League in New England. You know, it's gonna be online, and I wanted to see if you wanted to, you know, commentate the tournaments and, you know, do all this stuff. And he was, you know, he had a flyer up, it looked really nice, and he seemed very enthusiastic about it. It's like, all right, yeah, here's my email. Keep in contact with me, you know, let's go. I want to do this. I am full on board. I'm just hard charging right there. I'm gonna go. And I kept in contact with him, you know, hey buddy, what's going on? How's the update? You know, gotta keep on schedule. My old military mindset was like, all right, let's do this. And he became kinda less and less responsive to me until like he didn't talk to me at all. And so at that point in time, I ended up kind of slipping out of the commentator, like taking the commentator shoes off, and I started moving into the league and doing tournaments and whatnot. That's what I got for that.
So you can say the New England StarCraft League has almost been around since the StarCraft II beta.
Most of the, actually, all of the lands. Nope, I'm gonna rephrase that again. Most of the lands that started for StarCraft II were done by Bliss, and it was in the New England area. There were, oh, excuse me, there were two, I believe, two other people that started lands individual wise. One was Muzzy, and one of them, he goes by the name of Baneling now. He actually moved down to the Carolinas. But those two were the ones beside Bliss that were trying to throw lands, trying to develop, you know, just throw something, be a part of the land community. There was also a land center further up in Maine, Culture Crew Gaming. They were throwing their own land parties as well. But all of those people that I had just mentioned are now part of the StarCraft, the New England StarCraft League.
So, how specifically did you get hold of the reins and kind of become our fearless leader? You mentioned a few people before who had their hands involved in lands and things like that, but how did you specifically get hold of the New England StarCraft League?
All right. Well, like I said, you know, somebody else, he used to go by the name Control. Not Jeff Robinson in Control, but Control. He's the one that originally had the idea and brought it to everybody else. And a lot of people were excited about that. And me being, having gone to all the lands that Bliss had thrown, gone to, you know, that one that Muzzy had thrown, that long one, there was a large community in New England. I mean, people were coming out from New York to play in these lands. People were driving up from Rhode Island. I mean, they were driving crazy distances into Maine, into New Hampshire, just to play StarCraft. So the demand was there. The community was excited. And this person, this one guy, he had this great idea. And just like the proverbial ball, it got dropped. And I didn't want to see that happen. I saw all this great potential, and I wanted to be a part of it. I wanted to help it. I wanted to nurture it. So I grabbed that thing up, and I just started running with it. And when I was at the lands, let's see, that one was in September. So between September and I think it was December, every LAN that was brought up that I was able to go to, that I did commentary to, I talked with people about it. Like, hey, you know, remember that idea about the New England StarCraft thing? Well, I'm picking it up where he left off. You know, what would you think about doing the league? And I started talking to a bunch of the different people about that. You know, hey, there's this thing that I want to do. I want to do this. Like, we could have our own private ladder that, you know, it's still done on Battle.net, But it's our ladder thing, and that's in development right now. And we have our own private website and tournaments, like how about qualifying tournaments? And there was a lot of response from the community, and the community just started getting more and more excited about what was going on. So, me asking all these questions, getting all the details, I started talking with a couple of the other guys, like, okay, I need a website, so I need somebody that knows some website stuff. Well, Imberanger helped me out a little bit with that. I need, we need hosting, so we're gonna need sponsorship. So, I was searching around for sponsorship. Luckily, a local place, Megahertz Computers, they offered web hosting for us, and doing all that. So we got this for free. It's all right. We got this great web space. There's guys that work there that play StarCraft. Awesome. They're in the league now, and they're helping out. And I just kept, all right, I'm doing the commentary, so all these people know me. I'm bringing these ideas to the table, so a lot of people, I'm getting a lot more face time. So there was really no chance for me to kind of step aside. And to be honest with you, I didn't really want to do it. I wanted to keep pushing forward with this. And that's really how I stayed at the forefront, and I'm, in charge of the league now by doing that. And December 4th, which is actually where I met you at Boomkins, was the very first day that the league was officially opened.
And we're nearing the end of our first season. How do you think the first season has gone, from a technical standpoint, I should say, pure, logistics of LAN centers, technology and casting and streaming wise? I know you said you're very new to this, so is there any particular things that just kind of came out of the woodwork and surprised you? How just was organizing this whole ordeal?
Well, for somebody who's never done anything like this, for a field that I've never moved into before, complete greenhorn in all aspects of everything that was going on. Maybe not the organizing, 'cause I was a sergeant in the army for a while, so I did have to have some type of organizational skills, some type of people skills. But from a technical point, being not having experience doing any of this, the first season went fairly well. I mean, it could have gone a lot better, but it went fairly well. We did have a lot of technical difficulties, like for instance, stream. Sometimes I actually switched from several of the different streaming software. I'm not gonna drop names out, but I actually had to switch streams from one to another because we were having lag issues, and it ended up being the streaming software. But then we went to a different LAN center and we were having broadcasting problems, and it wasn't my computer, but it was their internet connection. And we had to work through a lot of troubles. And as Miss Geek, who's been helping me run the tournaments, administer a bunch of stuff, she's been controlling the brackets, doing all that kind of stuff. She's freaking phenomenal. And as Miss Geek pointed out, it wouldn't be a New England StarCraft II League tournament unless something went wrong. Every single tournament that we've done, something's gone wrong. Like the last one that we had in Dover, it was originally supposed to be in Haverhill, Massachusetts, but we had to change it over to Dover. And then when we were at Dover, I was lucky enough to get Force to help me commentate. My computer kept dying. I found out personally that it was a heating issue. I did not have enough cooling. So, my computer died, so we were only on his stream and not my stream as well. So it just, a lot of little technical things with the commentary, maybe, it's taking a little bit between too long between matches or just something like that. And again, as never doing this ever before, our first time ever doing it, it went pretty well. Just it could have done better.
When you started the New England StarCraft League, did you expect to see some of the high caliber of play coming out of many of these players. I mean, I know we have a few masters and high diamond level players. Did you expect to find this amazing talent pool here in New England?
We are getting guys that should, some of the guys that we have should be ranking in Grandmaster when that comes out. I can tell you that now. From the earlier lands, I noticed that there was a competitive scene. It was a very friendly competitive scene. And as more lands came up, as more people, joined Team Liquid or there was a tournament that somewhere that was in New England, you got more and more people showing up. And at first I was amazed at how much the people were dedicated, but then when more and more people showed up that were like, well, at the time diamond level, high diamond, but very high master level, we're talking like 3300 3500 master in the BattleNet season one, and very high diamond players like showing up. You're like, holy cow! Like even now, it's amazing that it re it, I'm still amazed that there are people that are so high ranked. Like apparently, before the reset, there is a 4,000 point master player in New England. Miss Geek met him and actually saw it. It's he's a legit person. He hasn't signed up for any of the tournaments. He's aware of them. I don't know where he is, but this is a person that lives in New England. Who would have thought that we had that kind of skill here in New England? Well, show up to the tournaments and you actually start to believe that we really do have that, and it's true.
And I must say, I'm a self-proclaimed noob of StarCraft. I'm a Silver League Protoss. So, but I notice when I do Fight Night, it's still a highly competitive scene between our bronze or silvers and our golds, especially also doing the bronze to gold tournament. Would you say there is a highly competitive noob scene, if you will?
Absolutely. I work with, he's a rank 50 bronze player, both on his Protoss account and on his Zerg account. And every day when I'm at work, I take a break and call it my second breakfast. And he comes down and we talk StarCraft. Most of the time it's him telling me what he did on the ladder or saying something like, how do I beat this? Or, when am I doing this? And he's a bronze player. He's been bronze since beta started, but he wants to get better. And we have silver players that again, we have bronze players that have beaten platinum players, if you can believe that. People that have been so competitive that they went from a I'm only going to assume a really negative MMR to practicing their asses off in like custom battles with other people to be able to compete with platinum level players. I mean, that's really amazing. I mean, as you go from rank to rank, bronze, silver, gold, platinum, diamond, master, and then eventually grandmaster, the gap between the bottom and the top starts to get bigger and bigger as you move on, but still, bronze to platinum, or silver players being able to compete with diamond players, we have these kind of people in New England, and a lot of the tournaments are catered towards the higher level people, the noobs, as you put it, and as I am myself. We're competitive too, and we want our own tournaments. And, it's there. The competition is there. I mean, we had set up. I was only able to get one of them set up just because there was a whole lot of issues. But a couple months ago, we actually had a bronze to gold tournament, and I set it up so that all the bronze people played each other, all the silver people played each other, and all the gold people played each other. And then at the end, the winners of those like mini brackets got to face off against each other. So like you enter a tournament, you're bronze, you have to face, it's a bronze to gold tournament, so you have to face a gold guy. You get knocked out right away, or you have a tough time. So all the bronze people think, I am never going to win anything of that. Well, with the tournament setup that I did for bronze to gold, a gold person wins, a silver person wins, and a bronze person wins. So even at that level, you keep encouraging the competition at the lower levels, and I can throw more of these bronze to gold tournaments, and we can get more people in there, and I really want to get like develop those players to continue being competitive, even if they don't move up to, platinum. Who cares? They're competitive, they're having fun, it's great. Bronze to gold, it's the way to be.
And a personal note from the tournament, I was the Silver League winner in the end. But I remember that round robin was pretty crazy. I mean, I was taking games off our gold Zerg, and the frickin' bronze Terran was whipping me around. He was just beating me into a bloody pulp. And that was the same across the board. Our leagues didn't matter at that point. We were all just competitive players going at it, trying to win first prize. And I'm sure watching it was interesting, but playing in it was a really exhilarating time for me. And I know in most tournaments I will never get that because I am not a Master League player, so it was amazing to have that competitiveness in a lower level tournament.
That was it. That was really a good fight between all of you guys. That round robin play.
So, coming up, we have our last chance tournament and our grand finals. Who do you think the last few people will be to qualify for the grand finals who haven't already? And more importantly, who do you think in the end will bring it all home? The large cash prize? The honor and dignity of winning the very first New England StarCraft League tournament? As well as the title and the bragging rights of winning the very first New England StarCraft League title, season one title.
Well, it's hard to really. Well, I mean, I can list off seven players that have the potential for filling up the last spots in the for the grand finals. I mean, we do have that last chance tournament on Saturday the 16th in Dover, but there's seven open spots that people can take to go to Sunday, but it's a single elimination tournament. So if somebody has a bad day, there's no coming back. It is best of three, but I can't say like, okay, who's in the tournament? I'm actually looking at the list right now. We have Kelson in there, we have Ducky Ranger, we have Ember Ranger right there. Those are three people that can move on to the next day. But what happens if we set up the random brackets? Ducky gets set up against Kelson. Somebody's going to end up losing, so they're not going to make it all the way there. I mean, I would like to hope that like three of those guys, even Disturbance, I haven't seen him play. I've heard nothing but great things about him. I'd like to see him move on, but it's not guaranteed when it comes to this last chance tournament. So it's really hard to determine out of that group who's going to be showing up the very next day, who's going to be able to qualify. Now, as far as the guys that are already in it, we have let's see, Ryan Nova or Ryan from Complexity Gaming. We have Toxic Gaming's Insulator. We have HP the Great all the way from New York. We have the Green Ranger from Massachusetts. Recon's actually one of his friends. We have Damcats, who's older than he's looked. Older than he looks. We have the infamous Last Shadow, who's a freaking amazing player. He actually qualified in the last tournament, and he's been going in and out, and he's going to be showing up in the tournament, and it's going to be great to see him again. We also have Oso and Bronzny filling out the very last spot. Now, out of those guys, I mean, every single one of these people qualified in the top three in one of the qualifying tournaments that I threw. So all of these guys have the potential towards the end. But really, if I was going to pick someone that may take it all, I think it's actually out of this nine, either going to be Ryan or Last Shadow, just based off the performances I see. But again, this is a double elimination. All of these guys have the capability of taking it all the way and winning first place.
Now, I have to ask, how has been working with Blizzard and our LAN centers, how has working with them been? And also something that probably a lot of people wouldn't really know about is, but are probably very interested in, is how has been getting sponsors been going? Has it been an easy process? Have sponsors been really interested in the prospect of the league? Or have you really been just shaking down companies and getting no results?
Working with Blizzard or getting official licensing from Blizzard is a pain in the butt. But you know what? It is worth it to be able to do it legitimately. I mean, we're doing these tournaments. There is some profit involved. It's not my profit. A lot of it has to go back into the league just so that we can keep doing it. We have to get some of the money to the LAN centers. So there's a lot of money changing hands, and Blizzard needs to know, are you making money off of this? Like, I know myself and you have talked about doing something with television. Well, that's a very, very sticky subject for Blizzard. So they need to know, okay, you know, when is this stuff going to happen? Are you going to be making money off of it? Is somebody else going to be making money? They need to know all these things. So working with Blizzard is really hard, and we're actually still waiting on some of the final steps just for television specifically. But I think with the answers that I provided and you and your coworker provided, we should be closer to an agreement and getting everything set so that we can do it, no problems, get everything done. The LAN centers, all of the LAN centers have been very receptive. The only difficulty I had per se, and it wasn't really a lot of difficulty, was up in Maine, Culture Crew Gaming. The two owners there are very involved in the tournaments that they do. They are probably the most involved LAN center owners that I've met in quite a while, and they love running their own tournaments. They ran the first StarCraft tournament they ran it themselves. They run Black Ops tournaments. They run, you know, League of Legends tournaments. They run, you know, all of these tournaments, and they do it themselves. So when I proposed them the idea about it, they were a little skeptical at first because, you know, they wanted to be involved, and it was just a minor communication thing. But now, they are fully supportive of everything that I'm doing. They want to help out. They want to host. All right. Now, when it came to the sponsors, they've been really difficult to kind of wrangle in at first. I mean, like I said, I was lucky enough to get the sponsor with Megahertz Computers, and a lot of the places that I requested sponsorship from, you type out the email, you send the phone call, and you get absolutely nothing back. Or you get, you know, oh, we're not entertaining sponsorships right now. Oh, we're not doing anything like this. Now, when I had originally started this, this was before anything about MLG came out. So, you know, this is just some random person trying to run some LAN center thing. You know, we're just trying to do this. So no type of sponsors were interested whatsoever. Now, you know, we got the occasional one like, hey, you know, we'll try it out for you as Mana Potions, like, you know, we'll send you some stuff, see what we can do with that. But it really has been, that's been probably one of the most difficult things with getting all of this put together, was getting the sponsors. And because of the lack of sponsors, I actually have to charge people, or the LAN center has to charge. I can't cover the fee for the grand finals to actually view it. I wish I could, but again, it's a sponsorship thing. As of recent, though, it has been a little bit better, and I guess you wanted to talk about that a little bit later. Okay, so I guess we can talk about it now. Since PAX East happened a couple months back, I went to it, and I basically tried to network with a bunch of people. I handed out business cards to people. I handed out to businesses, shot like little sales pitches talking about it. And especially since the Kingston HyperX booth was there, you could see the crowd of StarCraft people. You could see the craze behind it, the giant tournament that they had there. You know, you could see that this game that, you know, came out of 12 years of hibernation well, in our side of the country anyway, or our side of the world as opposed to like Korea, something was building up behind it. You could really start to see the momentum coming up behind it, especially since, the MLG season, excuse me, the MLG season had ended, and now we have PAX. It's big at PAX. They need a bigger area for StarCraft next year. Now we have MLG starting up again. And so I started talking with sponsors, and with the New England StarCraft League, we're ending our first season, so I need to start, or I needed to start talking with new sponsors, try and get more people on board as I'm getting more of my own free time available to do this kind of stuff. And the very first sponsorship that I entertained, that I did not meet at PAX, I got an email back saying that they were interested. And I chatted back and forth with them just a little bit, and the league now has a brand new sponsor, like legit sponsor. I'm not sure yet, if we're getting product or money for like the prize pools or anything like that. But we have a new sponsor, and I'm just going to let you know that it's Cooler Master. Woo! It's a big company. Cooler Master, they make the cases, they make the fans. They're going to be sponsoring us. That's amazing. So we have Megahertz Computers doing being a sponsor for us for the internet. They've taken care of all the internet stuff. They're sponsoring the Mumble server that we're using right now to do this. They're covering all those charges. That is a huge part of sponsorship for a league. Great. You got the prize pools, you got the equipment and stuff like that. But the website, it's all taken care of. I never have to worry about this again because of Megahertz. They're freaking phenomenal. And now we've got Cooler Master. And it's just not like a little company or anything. This is a big company. And just with that, if I go back to the people that I was talking to at PAX East, apparently, one of the guys that I was just chatting with at the Kingston HyperX booth was like a product manager for Kingston HyperX Memory. So I've been talking with him. Nothing's been made concrete yet. I would be freaking on cloud nine if we could also get, Kingston as a sponsor as well. And I'm going to keep working on that. But now that this big momentum's being seen in the crowd, the MLG, the PAX East, the GSL is being viewed a whole lot more. This past weekend in Dallas, there were so many people that went to view StarCraft 2 that they crashed the stream. Everything went down. I think they even crashed the city. Like nobody could check their Gmail. It was crazy. I might be exaggerating, like maybe an iota, but it just like even Sundance, the guy in charge of MLG, he was surprised at the sheer amount of numbers that people watching online, the people that showed up to watch in person. I mean, they filled up every single seat, and there was still like four or five deep rows of people watching the main stage. And this is all affecting like the sponsors. So it was difficult to get sponsors at first, but as we're moving along, I feel it's going to be a little bit easier and a little bit more to get sponsors to add on to the ones that we already have that are freaking phenomenal for like taking a chance and, in the league.
So I think this would be a great time for you to just talk about our sponsors. Really let the StarCraft community know who has taken the chances with us and who to support in future business endeavors, because these are the ones who are paying for part of our prize pools for these tournaments and helping out with all these different aspects of the league. Please talk about them and really pimp out their products, if you will.
Megahertz Computers is a local, they started off as a local computer repair shop in Bradford, Massachusetts. They've now expanded. They have a location in Amesbury, Massachusetts as well. They offer web hosting services. They do computer repairs. They'll do custom builds for you. The laptop that's sitting next to me, when I was overseas in Iraq, the owner of the store actually custom built this for me by my requests. And I got it when I came home on leave and brought it back to Iraq. And this puppy's still running. And that was back maybe like 6 years ago. The tower that I had just removed, all the guts that were in it, was all done at Megahertz Computers. They do everything. They'll clean your system. They even work, from what I've seen, they even work on networking and businesses. So if you have a small business and you need, the network set up and do it all that, they do that kind of stuff too. Let's see, who was the other sponsor? Mana Potions was a sponsor for us for season one. I think we might be losing them just because I haven't been able to get in contact with their lead. But from the get-go, they were actually the first sponsor before Megahertz, and they offered us products just like, hey, we want to support you. We're gonna put you on our page, or we're gonna send you out stuff. So they have like nichey little energy drinks. You go to look up Mana Potions, and you can get like little blue and little red energy potions. They also have like zombie blood and human blood. It's really nichey, but it's kind of cool. On the back of the human blood, it tells you how to microwave it so it's the right body temperature. I mean, that's kind of freaky, but that's awesome, and it tastes pretty good. Some of them, it depends on what your taste is. But I kind of like the health potions. It's got a funky taste to it. Let's see who else. Cooler Master, of course, is our new sponsor for next season. They make the towers, they make fans, they make just the stuff that they do, high quality, used for cooling down your systems. I mean, I have a brand new Cooler Master case. It's not from the sponsorship. It's just ironic that I managed to get one at the time. And the amount of flow that's being pushed down to my PC right now, the amount of air is incredible. I can put my hand in front of like my desk and feel air coming out, and it's cool air. The side of the case is cold. My old PC was nice and, nice and toasty warm, like it shouldn't be. And this is all stuff that Cooler Master does. And this is just a, stock case with some extra, stock fans. Who else? Oh, our t-shirt guys. The t-shirts that we have for the league, a local company called Lefties in Derry, New Hampshire. I talked with them looking for local sponsorship to kind of help us out with t-shirts or money or something like that. And he offered, some deals. Albeit, the prices of cotton have been going through the roof, so the shirts are costing more and more. But, he helped save us money by, all the specialty screens that we do. He gave us a discount on those, so we were able to get the cheaper screens. But they do t-shirts, they do sweaters, sweatshirts, hoodies, they do banners, not like the little pendant ones, but the big banner things. They do the ink printing, they do digital printing. The owner, extremely nice, knows what he's doing. On small orders, he actually hand rolls the some of the applications, and it comes out really, really nice. So it's high quality stuff. They've been around business for a long time. I think it's like left-tees.com or something like that. But they put out some really great stuff, and they've made all the shirts for the league. In fact, today I just picked up an order of a bunch of mediums and a bunch of smalls that will be available at the next tournament. And all the LAN centers that we have, of course, they're the top-notch sponsors, because we actually get to play at their locations. Let's see, Culture Crew Gaming in Standish, Maine. We have Gaming Galaxy in Dover, New Hampshire. We do have Boomkins in Haverhill, but they're moving. And yeah, I think that's all the land set. Oh no, Connecticut. Friendly Fire Gaming in Connecticut. It's a new location that we're adding for season two. They are full on board, ready for us to have a tournament there. It's great. That's what I got.
Well, then this is a fantastic time to move on to the speculations for the second season of the New England StarCraft League. What changes are you planning to implement? Any improvements? Anything you want to go back from season one and fix? Pretty much in general, what can a player of New England expect from the second season of the New England StarCraft League?
Last night, we were having a meeting with The ladder, which we didn't have first season, we are trying to get the ladder program up and running so that we have a personal ladder for season two. Now, what this ladder will do is you're required to play a certain amount of games, and the top three ranked people in the ladder that are not already seeded in tournaments automatically get into the grand finals for free. Now, again, like I said, you have to play a certain amount of games and you can't have already qualified. Now, one of the other things is you might have the best record in the world, but if you don't have those games, then you miss out on your spot. So that's going to get done. We have a new design for the website coming up. Right now we have a Simple Machines forum and we have a WordPress front page. Well, Quizzy's one of the guys that works at Megahertz. He's actually merging the two of them together. Not really merging, but he's basically creating a new website and utilizing both of them and bringing it together. We got M Bombs who designed the shirt. He's designing like a new backdrop for it. It's just the new website's going to look really, really nice. Also, in season two, we're expanding our locations. Now, we're going to have Dover. We're going to have Maine, Standish, Maine. We're adding Connecticut. It's Storrs Mansfield, Connecticut. It's right near Yukon. And I freely invite anybody that wants to drive from New York, anybody that wants to drive from New Jersey, if they want to join the forum and they want to be part of the New England StarCraft League, come out and join the tournament and play. I think it'd be great to have people all the way from from further west, the quote unquote extension of New England joining us, because it is a community. I don't want to exclude anybody from it. What else in season two? Season two, we're trying to get a game in Massachusetts. There were some problems. There were some problems with one of the land centers as far as getting computers, and they're actually moving to Plaistow, but still looking into computer things. But we need a land center in Massachusetts, like in Boston. We need something there, and nothing's really there right now. So I'm working with a couple of the universities in Boston, trying to see if I can get a land set up there. So we won't be at a land center, but we'll be on one of the college campuses utilizing their facility for the New England StarCraft League. Now, the best part about this is there is a huge community of the collegiate StarCraft League people in Boston. There's a fresh rotation every year of new people that may be playing or whatever, and even just the population in Boston, very dense. So having a land there has some really, really great potential for the league, for local businesses, just for everybody. So I'm really trying to get that to happen in season two. I think that's all I have in season two right now. Oh no, if you're listening to this and you go to a college in the Boston area, see what it would take to have a tournament on site, or just kind of ask around, like, hey, I know somebody that wants to, put an event on here. What needs to be done? And just shoot me an email, find me in game, do something to grab me. Be like, hey, this is who I talked to. Here's their number. Do you want to send them the pitch? Because we have enough computers to do this. We have 12 computers that can handle StarCraft on Medium. That's all you need. I mean, you can suffice with 10 computers to run a 32-man tournament. It takes about 8 hours, but if you go to a college in local Boston or somewhere in here, I want to get into Vermont eventually. If you go to school in Vermont and there's a StarCraft community there, but nothing's really happening, or even if your site can just support the computers, find out what you need to do, send me an email and I'll do the rest. I will try and get something on that campus and get it involved in the league. But really, right now, what we need is someone in Boston. So, for like the fourth, fifth time that I said it, if you're interested, if something can happen on your campus, get the ball rolling and I'll help you push it along.
Well, so far everything we've been talking about has been phenomenal, And if I was someone who was not currently in the league, or someone who wanted to help out more with the league, where can I go? What website? Who can I come and talk to for the league? Just any website or contact information would be fantastic.
If you want to get involved in the league, just involved in general, head to NESC2League.com. That's New England StarCraft II League.com. All together. You can Google it. You will find a link to it. It is there. You can get involved just by joining the forums and, you know, chatting in the suggestion box, or not the suggestion box, but just chatting with everybody in the forum saying hi. If you log on to StarCraft II, go into the private channel NE space SC2 space league, and we'll be there. There's people there all the time. They may not chat because a lot of people, you know, they're competitive, so they're laddering pretty hard, or they're doing the private games or something, but we are there. We will talk. Now, if you want to get involved on a different level, like maybe you want to help, like maybe Force, who lives in New Hampshire, he might not be able to make the trip all the way down to Connecticut. If you have some commentary experience and, you know, maybe you want to offer some commentary, or maybe you want to write a news article for a local paper or do a blog or something like that, get in contact with me at Drogeth@NESC2League.com. It's as simple as that. You can also find me on Team Liquid as Drogeth. I also have an account as NESC2League. Ta-da! Just shoot a PM over. I'll be able to easily get back to you, tell me what your idea is, what you want to do, and I can see how I can help you get involved in the community, or even just, you know, you want to get involved, start doing something. I mean, you don't really need my permission, but, you know, I would like to help you get the most out of what you're doing to help push you along as well. I mean, it's really about the community over the competition, and, you know, if one hand washes the other, then everybody benefits from it. Oh, yeah, so like I said, if you want to contact me, just, you know, log on to the forums and start chatting, or shoot me an email, you know, drogeth@NESC2League.com. And that's really it. We can move on from there.
Well, we're hitting the 50-minute mark soon, so I want to start wrapping this interview up, but I want to kind of end it in a fun, positive way. So, give me your favorite race, your favorite unit, your favorite matchup, and your favorite map, as well as your least favorite matchup, unit, and map.
I am a Protoss for life. Love the Protoss. My favorite unit is a Phoenix. If we're doing team mono battles, I'm going Phoenix. That's just the way it is. I mean, I'm a mid-silver level player, and I'll grab those things, and I'll pound G so fast, your mineral line will disappear, and you won't even know what happened. You know what happened? Drogeth was using Phoenixes. I don't really have a favorite map. My favorite matchup is versus Zerg, though, just because I seem to fare better against Zerg than I do against Terran. So I guess Terran or Protoss actually would be my least favorite, because favorite a lot. So. but again, I don't really. Oh no, favorite map. IC Cup Test Bug. We support a lot of the IC Cup maps in the league, and Test Bug came out, and it's been a fan favorite. It's been like the Lost Temple, or the Zelnaga Cavern of IC Cup. Test Bug is just phenomenal as far as maps go.
And with that, I'd like to wrap up our interview. I would like to personally thank you for taking a decent chunk out of your day to come talk to me about the New England StarCraft League. I hope everyone found this as informative and interesting, actually, as I did. I am very much looking forward to the second season from the things you've mentioned and told me. And again, I'd like to thank you for your time, Drogeth, and I will give you the last words of the evening.
All right, well, Schreeder, Brady, I would like to thank you very much for taking the time to interview me. You're my first interview, and this is the first interview that I've done, and I'm kind of honored to do it. And again, the New England StarCraft League isn't just about the competition. We are very competitive, but it's the community first, getting everybody involved. That's why we do most of the tournaments on site, so that you can see who you're gaming with face to face and really feel like a part of the community. So we're out there. Come and join us, and I'll see you guys in game.